So agency life as we know, knew it has changed drastically over the past couple of years. And while we can blame it on the pandemic for bringing about drastic shift in the way digital agencies function, it's kind of undeniable that the pandemic compelled agencies to innovate like never before. Today I'm in discussion with the founders of some of the finest digital agencies in India, and we aim to discuss the challenges that they're facing in these very testing times. Basically, we'll discuss how the client agency relationship has evolved. Among these things, we'll also discuss the significance of awards and accolades. And overall, the discussion will also focus on the future of marketing and technology. Right? So these agencies that we have today, they have time and again proved their mettle, not just at award shows like our very own Front Benchers, but their clients have also been they're very big supporters and have voiced out their worth to the larger crowd. So I'm just naming them out who have took pains to join this webinar today, because this cannot be their intro. Their intros are all 2-3 pages long. So my first guest today is Shraddha Agarwal. She's the CEO of Grapes Digital. Hi, Shraddha.
Hey.
My second guest today is Prasad Sujale. He's the founder and CEO of LogicServe Digital. Welcome, Prasad.
Hey, hi there. Hi, everyone.
My next guest today is our very own Prashant Puri. He's the CEO of Adlift.
Hi, everyone. Hi,
Prashant.
Paul.
My fourth guest today is Suvir Bajaj. He's the co-founder of Zoom Media and Foxymoron. Hi, Suvir. Good to have you back.
Hi, Rahul. Thanks for having me.
My next guest is Sanjay Arora, who is the CEO of Ants Digital. Welcome, Sanjay.
Thank you so much, and hi everybody. Great to have being over here. Thank you.
My final guest today is Advait Dudu, a dear friend and our longtime supporter. Basically, Advait is founder and CEO of Alive Now Creative Tech Studio. Hi, Advait.
Hey, Rahul, good to be with all of you.
All right, so now I guess we can move to our panel discussion. So this first question is about cultural changes at your respective agencies. And this one is for each one of you. I'll basically take a minute, maximum two, to let us know what cultural shifts have you seen in your respective agencies over the last few years. It could be to attract more talent, give clients more value, or it could have helped you get more clients on board. Could be anything. So Shraddha, you can go first, followed by Suvir, Prashant, Advait, Prasad, and then Sanjay.
Sure. So I'll take the question more from the front of employees. You know what, it was very easier to connect with people and employees as you generally used to catch up before and after meeting while traveling to and back from client's office, on tapris, on foosball tables. But post-COVID, now this has completely changed. We are booked in back-to-back meetings. I think it's generally 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, and like that. And our conversations have become very transactions, like you go in, you go out of the meeting. It actually has become so important for us to spare time out to create a better culture in the organization. So we had to take a lot of effort in terms of doing this during COVID times, and especially when you're working from home. So we actually created something called as Beer JSRs that we do every Friday in smaller groups with different clusters. We also have arranged clubhouse sessions to gather certain employees to make them aware about new cool stuff and social media, share similar viewpoints. We've also started sending tokens of love on their birthdays and work anniversary, celebrating their 6 months and a year. And we've also started something called as Grapes Ka Swag, which where we invite employees to create campaigns right from bigger ideas to smaller topical posts and do these huddles so that these internal customers can come up with good stuff and they feel proud about it when they share in the WhatsApp groups. So those are the kind of things that we've taken in order to attract the right prospects, or just, to be honest, just to boost the morale of the current employee set that we have.
I'll pick up
All
from
right.
where Shraddha left off. And I think it's pertinent for our listeners and people who've tuned in today to also realize that with all of us in the digital ecosystem, we work with very, very young teams, right? Possibly the youngest in the digital industry in comparison to most other industries. And obviously, the penchant for social interactions is so high, as Shraddha spoke about. And something that I've actually noticed emerge over the last year and a half is, while a lot of work used to get done when people sit face to face because there's camaraderie and there's dependence on the people sitting, in your team, in your cohort with you, today a lot of that work needs to be be done independently, right? Because interactions have become transactional. The dependency on self has become so much more. And of course, that's great because it's built a lot of accountability, but it also has a lot of challenges in terms of the pressure that it puts on individuals as well. So there's a very heavy element of, you know, stress and pressure that we've also needed to work through. And personally, something that I've enjoyed in terms of managing this over the course of the last year is, while there's a lot of emphasis that's actually gone on personnel development and people, there's this other aspect of culture, which is ways of working, right? Because we've had to reinvent the ways of working while we've been sitting at home for the last 1.5 years. And, you know, the agencies over here must be having strict processes that they kind of follow to ensure adherence of SOPs and stuff like that. But over the last year, everyone's had to rewrite process from scratch. And that's been so rewarding to an extent because, we're all digital guys here. And now we've been able to digitize our own businesses in entirety, 100%. And we see everything that we talk about as far as business come to life, as far as our own organizations are concerned. So I think when we've taken the onus to rewrite process and translate that into ways of working to build accountability between individual and team, I think it's been really, really rewarding. Like Shraddha mentioned, of course, you know, at the same time, you can't discount the human element that everyone tries to kind of build in. We had something called Foxy Fridays that we used to institute, where the entire organization used to come together on Friday. I used to have a small celebrations, birthdays, milestones, etc., which we now try and digitize. And we try and make it interactive through singer-songwriters, stand-up comedians that bring a little bit of entertainment and essentially bring bonding around similarities and cohesive commonness between the organization. So I think it's been a very, very fair share of putting new processes, new ways of working together, along with a lot of new people, because so many new people have joined the organization in the last 1 year as well, right? Last year and a half as well. And to be able to induct them into these new ways of working as far as culture, ethics, values, morals. And we as an organization pay a lot of importance to our value systems, and to inculcate those values with people you've never met in your lives, I think it's been a really rewarding challenge in that context.
Rewarding and exhausting.
Yes.
Yeah, no, so just to piggyback off what Shraddha and Suvir called out, I think, you know, last 1.5 years, when I kind of look back and then kind of map that out to the previous 1.5, I think two key challenges are, now's the time where most people are, you know, communicating through emails, Zoom calls, sometimes the camera's on, sometimes it's off, and a lot of WhatsApp messages. And lots gets, you know, lost in translation when you're not face to face, and especially where, you know, as Suvir mentioned, it's a young blood group. Everyone, you know, was used to working face to face. Now it's through WhatsApp. So we've done a lot of communication training, pretty much going back to basic, right? Understand what the other person is going through. Pick up the phone if you need to call. You know, switch on the camera. All of these things, you know, add. When you're not like face-to-face in a room, when you're face-to-face in the room, problems pretty much disappear. But when you're like, you know, looking to solve for problems cross-functionally, you know, there are lots of head-butting. So how do we as a, you know, company eliminate as much as we can? So a lot of communication training happened and is happening. The other thing is, with all the hiring that's happening, it becomes easier when you kind of see the person in the office, name to a face, across each team. I'm not even talking cross-functionally. So when new people come in, they really feel alienated. So having a lot of, top-down and bottom-up conversations with the new employees, roundtable, really call out that, especially if you're in designations where, you know, CXO minus two or CXO minus three within the organization, how do you actually get that airtime? So a lot of the vertical heads, part of their to-do quarterly is to take out time to meet with employees over Zoom with cameras on, so that there's that, you know, inclusion. Otherwise, you know, earlier on, we got a lot of feedback that, you know, we're feeling alienated. We're doing our day-to-day, but, you know, when you're not there face-to-face and you see a human, you know, right there, even if it's your manager, it makes a huge difference. So a lot of inclusion programs is something that we've been working on.
Thanks, Prashant.
Rahul, I think after listening to Shraddha, Suvir and Prashant, one thing that I understood that is that most of the challenges that all of us are facing are quite common, given the kind of work that we're doing, given the kind of interactions that we have with our different teams and with the clients. I would say almost 80 to 90% overlap in, you know, the kind of challenges that all of us are facing. I think the only, instead of, you know, repeating what they said, the only two, three challenges, additional challenges that we faced are, you know, given that almost 70% of our clients and the work we do is overseas, you know, we half of my team was either in Singapore or Dubai or traveling somewhere or the other every 2 weeks or every month, right? And I used to travel a lot as well. So one is obviously we're missing that travel because, you know, when you travel for work, you also, it's also, you combine it with pleasure, right? So that is one, we're missing the travel. And two is we really miss meeting people because, you know, the kind of perspective and the kind of learning that we used to get when we meet brands and agencies in the Middle East and Singapore, these two are our two largest markets outside of India, it's very, very different, right? So we obviously have a lot of, you know, a lot of the agencies in India are also our clients. So I know you said we're all digital agencies, but we're not really an agency because we kind of did a pivot almost 5-6 years ago. All the other agencies are our clients, so we collaborate with them. So the first big challenge is, you know, not being able to meet people, especially overseas, learning about new trends, learning about things happening there, learning about what some of the clients over there are looking for. Thankfully, because of our, you know, relationships that we've established over the years, we've been able to continue that business, and, you know, we haven't had major impact in terms of top line and bottom line and all that. The second major challenge I think that we faced is we are a very, very tech heavy kind of organization. So we don't do a lot of creative or content. We do more of the tech centric stuff, building games and AR, VR and, you know, camera related stuff and all that. And for that, you know, interaction and constant discussion from the development team and the design team and the 3D team is so important. And that we almost used to take that for granted when we were in office. And now that everyone is remote, you know, that was a challenge in the beginning, but then it's improved quite a bit. So besides these two additional challenges that I can add to, I think I echo you know, Shraddha's and Suvi's and Prashant's thoughts. All those concerns, what they mentioned, even we have seen. Yeah.
Thanks, Adit, for your inputs.
Just Prashant, share a small. Okay, Prashant can go ahead. No worries.
Sure, you want to go first, Sanjay? You can.
Yeah, sure. No, I was just mentioning that, you know, this whole sentiment is, when you look at it, we are all digital companies, basically tech-led companies. And we were actually having an environment which was absolutely offline. So if you look at 2019, it was an offline environment. And we have really done this disruption now, wherein being a digital company, we are all online. So just think about this, you know, we were all people centric, we were facing each other, we were talking to each other. And like you were mentioning, I think, you know, we're a very young company and, you know, we face this challenge because we have these five verticals which are there. And some team members, like, for example, the creative and content vertical wants to function in office. Okay, they feel that, you know, the amount of time that goes in interacting and in just coordinating is just a waste of time. And, you know, online has been a real painful thing for them, for that matter. Whereas if you look at the tech team or the social team or the team which is into digital marketing, they're pretty comfortable with that. So I think we had to have some disruptive thought process over it in terms of a mix, you know. So whenever we've got the opportunity to, you know, run the office, people have been willing to come down to the office and work over there because you obviously have a face to see and you can interact and you can do a lot of work. But whenever there have been, you know, obviously lockdowns and all that, there has been a lot of sulking as far as, you know, team members are concerned, because not everybody is, when you come to office, you have an environment which is absolutely the same for everybody. But when you are in your own home, environments are different, absolutely. So I think that's something that as a challenge, this is something that we have, like Shraddha mentioned, processes and coming and talking to people online and wishing them and talking to them, whatever we might do, you know, I think that that touch, that feel, that emotion is completely missing. So yes, whenever I get an opportunity, I open the office and come and sit over here and ask people to come and work willingly if they want to come. So yes, that has been the process at our end. Yes.
See, I think very interesting here. Okay, if you see, we are in the services industry, and that too B2B. Okay, so people make what we are. Okay, and at the glue between, you know, sort of attaching or, you know, now getting everyone together and you know, giving that great output that we want is a culture is one of the most important glue that, you know, which binds us, all of us, right? And when I listen to all of you, it's about people, you know, it's about collaboration, it's about, you know, some of you have said about, you know, meeting in person and, you know, doing that jamming sessions and so forth, okay? So for me, you know, if I take back from a very a perspective of culture, and you know, this 1.5 years, a lot of thought process has gone through it. When you actually go through these moments that which happens. So what happens? Okay, culture. How does it get sort of generated? You know, what happens? Okay, so for me, I always say is that the first day in which the founder, you know, starts behaving in that office. Okay, that's the seed of the culture. Okay, and then of course, you know, it gets built over the time, and you know, the core team sort of imbibes that culture. Then new people come in. They come. You know, they come with their flavors of you know, different cultures which are there, but ultimately it's a amalgamation of you know, or the culture which probably the core team believes in. Okay, and the custodian of that culture has always been the leadership team, which always is there. Okay, so they are the one who probably are responsible for building whichever culture, good, bad, ugly, whatever it is, right? So coming to think of it, there are very interesting thing, and someone also mentioned about the values. Okay, so we have these 7 values which we believe in, you know, future ready, you know, knowledge seekers, passionate, integrated, proactive, efficient, and humane. Very interesting learning. What I realize during the normal times, what we would call, you know, pre-COVID, all these values, okay, of course, they were important at the almost a similar level, same level. But I realized in the first week when there are a lot of VUCA, okay, there are a lot of VUCA and a lot of uncertainties started happening, some of these values started playing a lot of bigger roles. For example, being humane. One thing that I quickly realized is that so much of uncertainty there, and a lot of you know, a lot of rumors, and you know, this time I think it was more of a health issues. People, I'm talking about last year March. What I started doing is that when I looked into myself, there are so many uncertainties within me. Okay, I have parents 85 years old in my, you know, family, you know, in my house now also. Okay, touch wood. So many uncertainties there. Okay, and if I looked into my mirror and said that, you know, what is it that you want? What is the most important thing that you want to do? What I started doing is that every day morning between 10:15 to 10:30, okay, I started going live to, you know, what we call Logimates. And it was no GAN. It was the learnings. Okay. And then every day someone else will start coming. So we realize, you know, whenever I see that video of 150 days, all of us human wise have similar values. It's just that we learn those values with different experiences. And when people share their experiences, people resonate with it. Okay. And that starts gluing the culture. Okay. And of course, then as things moved on, different things started getting, you know, when third, fourth month, when we thought of learning is important. Okay. That time, a lot of learning related stuff came in, and, you know, a lot of stuff, but that's what my learning is very, sometimes I really feel is that those, whatever you would have studied, read books, did workshops, had interacted, everything got used to during that, you know, I'm still saying it's still now, we are still not out of woods there. It's a very, what I would say, humbling and very different experience. I think all of us have gone through. Yeah.
Thanks, Prasad. I think you closed it. You closed loops on it really nice. The next one is let's say without describing these, as in you can give bullet points. What have been the top 3 challenges during the pandemic? When it came to retaining clients, and B, ensuring profitability during such difficult times, right? Shraddha, you can go first, and then sure. We'll keep the same order now.
Sure. So, I tell you the top 3 challenges. The first one has to be working on the same retainer fees. And I don't know how many of you resonate with me on that. I think we worked on the same retainer fees to retain those clients, and obviously even went to the extent of lowering project cost in certain cases. The second one was, I think, working around the clock. The client has lost track of time, weekday, weekend, 10 baje, subah 8 baje. Matlab, it was hilarious the way client was reacting on WhatsApps. Subah 6 baje, somebody's just got up and I'm getting a ping. Post mein na comma reh gaya. I'm like, okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. No, sir. And that's how it has been. But in terms of actually increasing the revenue, you know, one of the key things that we have really done is having meeting with MDs and EDs of the company rather than just the digital marketing head. Okay, because these guys were meeting Bains and Nielsen's, and they were had a lot of free time. They were not traveling and not meeting so many. So they had a lot of consultants coming in. So we were started churning data for them, right? A lot of data was going out to them where we were able to actually go and say that let's not do things only on digital. Let's think content first. Then see which platform will it go, whether it go to your even channel partners. Like in case of Hindware, we've gone down to connect with plumbers. So that is the way we've actually increased revenue in terms of doing projects more than just what the digital ecosystem allowed us to do.
Great. Suvir?
Yeah, I'll jump in next. I think the first, massive challenge when it came to retaining clients was aligning on ways of working, you know, and I think like Prashant and like Advait and Prasad, you know, they all spoke about sit down in front of a client face to face and you hash everything out and it's done in 30 minutes, 90 minutes, whatever the case may be. All of a sudden, you're not seeing your client for 1.5 years and they have a whole new way of working. You have a whole new way of working. You've got new project management tools and softwares and approval systems. And, you know, they've got an escalation matrix internally, which is brand new. And there's new COVID safety protocols as far as what you can do and what you can say. And this alignment of ways of working, the new ways of working, I think was a massive challenge, you know, that we faced. The second, very similar to what Shraddha said, is, you know, we, you know, and you know, because you use Hindware as well, it's a common client that we share. You know, my CTO Sid and I, we always say that we want to do work that impacts the stock price of a company. Like, that's our vision really for brands that we work with, that we want to do work that impacts the stock price of the company. And every single business or brand that we worked on had some depreciating revenue line and, you know, losing business everywhere. So I think generation of impact when it comes to either building a revenue channel or whether it comes to optimizing cost. And we've done a lot of work on both sides. Like, as far as stock tech is concerned, we've done a lot of digital transformation work where we've been able to transform certain offline processes and move them online, you know, where clients have cut costs and, you know, let go entire teams. And when it comes to generation of revenue, sales online, I mean, there's a very easy story to tell there with, you know, the people on this call. And I think the third thing, which has been the most interesting for me, has been evolving models. So, you know, Shraddha briefly spoke about a lot of consultants, and we do a lot of work with consulting companies, whether it be KPMG or Accenture, whatever the case may be. And we work on a lot of evolving models with them, saying, look, you understand that your customer cannot pay you X many $100,000 or $1 million per year, but what is the evolved model now? Can I discount my cash? Can you give me an upside? Can the upside come through revenue share? Can it come through sweat equity? Can it come through some sort of a barter, right? And these evolved commercial models have been very, very interesting, learning curve as far as retaining business is concerned. Will they pay off in the long term? Fingers crossed. Let's hope so. But I think very, very interesting learnings.
So he is working with real estate company saying, flat de do, main kaam kar deta.
Jewelers are the best to work for these times.
Yeah. Now that you're not getting ready, I don't know how much usage they'll come to, but yes.
Keep it in the locker. Gold is appreciating.
True.
Yeah, no, so, I mean, obviously, you know, working from home, clients, I think we can all call out our top 3, top 5, top 10 challenges. But I think, you know, I'll kind of just turn this around. We all, I'm sure, are very grateful that we are in the digital space. And one thing that's actually happened with COVID is the need for us, the 6-7 of us and, you know, more agencies has actually skyrocketed. So it goes back again to, you know, why is the, you know, on talking about profitability and, you know, increasing accounts and, you know, retaining accounts is, you know, why do they need you more, right? And that's actually a question that whether COVID or not was always being asked, right? I'm sure all of us are, you know, privy to that. Like, why should client A choose agency B and not C, and how do you retain? So that foundation during the COVID time had to be, if it wasn't there, had to be much faster, had to be built at a much greater rate to make sure that the client actually needs you more than ever, right? And if that, if there's a check there, then profitability, margins, you know, retainer amounts, all of that gets sorted. Also, having said that, you know, being partners, right? I know we call this out in pitches, but actually truly believing that, which is there are, you know, companies that are seeing a massive hit, they are seeing revenue. So how do you be partners in the short term for a longer term benefit on both sides, right? Versus saying, you know, it's not going to work. Basically alluding to, you know, what Suvir mentioned. So working on new ways of revenue model, not for everyone, obviously, for the ones that, you know, need it. It's a need of the hour. It's not like it's COVID and everyone's slashing prices. So, aap bhi please karo hamare liye kind of a thing. But wherever required, wherever there is that mutual agreement, working on those, right? So, I think these two have kind of, you know, kept us at AdLift in a good footing. And third, obviously, you know, we're just, you know, drinking the Kool-Aid. It's digital. Everything's like ramped up. Lucky to be in this space by design or by crook. So, it's been good challenges, which are laying the foundation for better things to come.
Right.
Rahul, so my thoughts, I think I don't really want to say challenges, because I think, you know, you usually like to use the word challenges when as an industry or as a company, we've gone through a little bit of a troubling period in terms of the work culture and everything. Yeah, it's been a little challenging, but frankly, in terms of work itself, I don't want to use the word challenging, because the last 4 or 5 quarters have been our best quarters ever, right, in terms of revenue and all of that. Now, what we did have to do, however, was that given that we don't have any retainer clients and all of our clients are a project basis, 1 month, 2 month projects, what we saw was very strategically and in a very targeted way, we had to work with brands and agencies who worked with brands in only sectors that were not affected by COVID. So for example, we reduced a lot of, we didn't do any work with travel, tourism, airlines, hospitality, all of these sectors, you know, in the regions that we operate, cut their budgets by 80%, 90%, some of them almost 100%. So given that we knew, you know, these agencies work with these brands, and these are some of the brands that we have to reach out to. So we were very, very, you know, calculated and very, you know, in a targeted way, reached out to the right sectors and the right brands. And that helped a lot, because, you know, we've done a bunch of pharma-related work in AR and gaming and all that we never thought we would ever do. But then these guys had so much money that they did not know what to do with it, and they were, you know, willing to experiment and do new and interesting things, right? So I think that is one, I wouldn't say challenge, it was more of, you know, looking at the market the way it is, and trying to see what you can make best out of the situation. In terms of actual working, I would say the biggest challenge that we did face was, you know, in our office itself, because of some of the little tech heavy stuff that we do. We have some systems that have really, you know, crazy processor speed and all of that. So it was a challenge saying, okay, how do we move this to another location, and how do we, because no one's coming to the office. So that, you know, we figured it out eventually, but then that was very challenging, because, you know, you had, you know, 3D people and tech people working together using these 2-3 systems that had such high specs. You know, we had to move all that. So that was a bit challenging. Other than that, like I said, I really don't want to use the word challenge, because I think challenge is when you have, you know, you've gone through, you know, some kind of trouble or things are not going that well. But I think for all of us, as Prashant said, we've just, you know, by luck or by hook or by crook, we're in the right place at the right time. And definitely we've seen a surge in demand for what we're doing, for sure.
In our case, I think initially it was a knee-jerk reaction, you know, in terms of when clients, nobody was aware what is going to happen in this pandemic, and, you know, everybody was taken totally by surprise. So, you know, the environment changed, the marketplace changed, and the consumption patterns have changed over there. And, you know, typically, most of the clients that we have signed are all industrial, manufacturing, you know, clients which had huge like sales team of 150 people, 500 people. And those clients have realized that, you know, no, it won't work like that. They'll have to change the game over here and they'll have to get into the digital wave. So initially, yes, there was, you know, for the first 3 months, we were all hit by surprise saying that, you know, we need to stay afloat, number one, because we are a bootstrap company. We don't have any, you know, large, you know, investors looking at us or stuff like that. But we are a bootstrap company and we were like, we had three things in our mind. We need to pay our people on time. That was very, very important because you need to really retain them, number one. Number two, you also need to take care of them in terms of their healthcare and in terms of their various other facilities that one can, you know, give to them. So that was on the human side of it. But from a, like Shraddha mentioned, I think I totally echo, you know, your sentiment, Shraddha. Retaining clients and giving them longer credit periods has been definitely a challenge over there. And believe me, you know, for a company which is of our size, which is mid-size, it was a challenge at that. But we saw that, you know, the way we moved ahead, and I think August 2020 onwards, we have been on a go. We have had clients and we've had, like, you know, one of you were mentioning that projects, you know, the kind of projects that have come to us, you know, you quickly do it, get that money and, you know, ensure that, you know, your operations are working in a proper manner. So I think that's been, you know, there has been an upsurge, almost 4,000% upsurge has happened in the digital economy per se. And I think we are lucky and, you know, we just count our blessings every day to say that, great, we are in this particular industry where it is growing at this point in time. So I wouldn't call it a challenge, like you mentioned, but at the same time, I wouldn't even call it an opportunity. It's a learning, honestly, for all of us to say that how we have changed gears with the time and we've done whatever was required from our side, whether it is to do with people or whether it is to do with clients or servicing them. And, you know, those calls which are coming morning, evening, no end to it. So I think, yeah, we've taken it, you know, as a learning. Yeah.
Very interesting. I think the challenges are very similar one. But so for me, what I would say is that we at the beginning, we use McKinsey's model of resolve, you know, at the beginning, you know, how to resolve the immediate problems and how to build the resilience and return and reimagination and reform. But what I understand what we are saying here is that retaining the clients and ensuring the profitability and how what are the challenges that we face. I think the first one, and there are three of those that I have to mention. The first one is definitely the collaboration, okay, because change of, you know, everyone has mentioned, you know, the change of working and, you know, no face to face. Okay, so that's something that we really had to work on. Second one, very interesting one, because when there are so many external parameters were changing and the way I think digital industry has changed a lot, how to get that integrated way of doing things, okay, from the digital perspective, so to say. Collaboration is about people, integrated is about the activities and things and the strategies that we are going to do. That's the second one. And the third very, very important one is that expectation management, because, you know, everyone is so many things in and around, okay, how to say that this is the scope, this is what we are supposed to do, and this is what you are supposed to do, and there are predecessors and, you know, things like that. Okay, so one is the collaboration, second is the integration, and the third one is, I think, expectation management is something that we really, really have worked. And as I said, the outcome of that 5-hour model that you said, really, we, as I see now, you know, all of us, I see the lot of friends in the industry and other side of the, you know, table also, clients also, many of us have reformed a lot. So we went through that 5-hour, okay, together, knowingly, unknowingly, kabhi girke, kabhi, you know, all sort of stuff which has happened. But that is where I think I would say these are the three challenges.
I want to talk about important events that maybe help you get noticed even more, right? Or it could have helped you in any way, some way. So in what ways does recognitions, awards help teams and agencies at large? Basically before you nominate or after you win, what is the typical client agency conversation? Let's say a client has to tell you something in 30 seconds, or you have to tell the client in 30 seconds, what would it be? Let's keep ourselves to 30 seconds really. Yeah, the same order.
Okay.
So and then we'll have specific questions for each one of you.
Got it. So 30 seconds, what the client has to say when we tell them you won this award.
You or client, whichever way, either way.
Okay, I'll take a, if I'm talking to the junior person in the client side, I'll say, what will you show in your appraisal? So you need to win this award. And if I'm talking to the MD or the ED, then I would be like, sir, your brand scores will improve with this award. Imagine people are not just PRing about the brand or the company. They need PR in the marketing and advertising journals about the campaigns that you've done. That's it. And we get the approval for them.
Approval. Yeah, that's witty. So we
always say that, your work speaks for itself. You win an award, it's validation for good work, right? It's as simple as that. It's a validation for good work. It's really, really simple. And it's motivation for the teams that put in that work. I think it's very easy.
Right. Prashant?
I mean, I think, most folks that we work with, they love awards, right? Everyone loves awards. So it's an easy sell. There are some that you kind of gauge when you are working with them or you bought them on, that they won't be actually, it's no point bringing it up because they're like, boss, revenue, report, revenue, right? So very numbers focused. So we kind of gauge that and we don't bring that up. But for the most part, I would say 80, 90% of the folks, they love it. They love awards. They love the recognition top down. LinkedIn is, I think, become a huge factor and facilitator of awards and why it's become more and more important, right? So pretty much an easy conversation to have.
And the 10% who say that they don't love awards, they only say it when it comes to fill the nomination fees. Then they'll be like, yeah, we got this award.
True. Everyone loves awards. Adit, you're not an agency, but have you participated?
I was just going to say, we've made a very conscious decision almost 4 or 5 years ago to not participate in awards, primarily because we work with agencies. And it's the agencies who we collaborate with, they are the ones who apply get awards. Sometimes they mention us, sometimes they don't, but that doesn't really matter. I think we really believe in what we do. That's why, that's actually one of the reasons I was very, very excited and happy to support you guys for Front Benchers, because we love the agency ecosystem and we want agencies to do a lot of good work. And one way of us saying thank you to the agencies and supporting is to collaborate with you guys, Rahul, and do awards like this. So some amazing entries that we got. I reviewed most of them, and we scored it. So we don't really take part in awards. I guess I can say we don't take part in the awards, but we like to sponsor the awards. So I don't know.
19th July is the next one that I'm launching. 19th of July. Note
sure.
Coming to you.
Yeah, sure. But sorry, just to add on, I think...
Advit, the center AR filter, we won a lot of awards for that.
Oh, that's great. I'm very happy for you guys and the client. That's fantastic. Yeah, very nice. So just to add one more thing, Rahul, I think because you're talking about awards and the how awards are about recognition, for us, where we, thrive on our recognition and we really, when we get recognized is the platform. So we work very closely with Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok, not in India, but in other regions, in ByteDance and all that. And we're official partners with all of them. So when they highlight our work, and when they talk about our work, that is a very big deal for us. And of course, the brand and agency also comes to know. So that is very, very important for us. We recently became official global partners with 8Wall, which is a web AR platform globally. And we're the only Indian agency, Indian and Middle East agency to be there. And we've done some amazing web AR related campaigns. And when platform talks about that, that makes us happy and makes our team happy, and it's a very motivating thing.
All right, that's one way to put it.
Yeah, I think, you know, Advit said it very rightly. I think it is to do with the platform also. It is important that the platform is credible, where, you know, wherever you are, actually, when you're putting your work out over there, there's somebody who is able to look into it deeper. And then, you know, so yeah, of course, you know, for team, it is a big, big morale booster. It is definitely, because, you know, you, the team start thinking like that, and, you know, and it is great because you are doing some great work for which you are being, you know, a pat on the back is coming from the industry. Nothing like it. Wonderful it is. And of course, for the client also, because you've run a campaign for so long, and the client feels that this really deserves something, you know, more than, you know, what their employees or their management or our team and our work is doing over there. I think it's something when you have a credible partner or a credible agency which is looking at awards and giving you and gratifying you with that, I think that that really is a morale booster. I think it's a win-win situation for everybody. It's just that, you know, you need to be sure what you're putting up over there. So that's very important, I guess.
All right. I think, yeah, from my side, if you see, all of us are human beings. Okay, all of us love that recognition, you know, that that appreciation, that adulation. Okay, unless, of course, on a Maslow's hierarchy or move to a self-actualization mode. Okay, but I think that is where it comes from. But apart from that, you win or you don't win it. Okay, if the work is good and you strongly believe in it, okay, then the world needs to know about it. Okay, and if you're not the best of best, then at least you know where you stand. Okay, so I look at that way. Okay, you, if the work is good, we are proud of it. Okay, then why not put it in front of everyone and, you know, say that, give me feedback. Okay, if I deserve to be winning, okay, then let's win. Okay, so that's how probably we would look at that way, and that's always been a pitch to the client. If we strongly believe the work is great, we should take it out and show it around. If you don't think, then I would say no, let's not do it. Let's not do that. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a common belief. Next, what we're going to do is we'll have specific questions for each one of you. In the interest of time, I think we'll have one question for each one of you. Let's consider this as the closing question from my side. And I'll begin with Shraddha again. So, Shraddha, help us understand some key efforts that you undertake to drive your relationship building process with the client, right? One or two of them, just quickly.
So I'll say only one word, which is the key mantra at Grips, which is called ownership. I genuinely believe whether you know anything, because nobody learns digital marketing. Recently, courses have started. But if you have ownership, now everything else will fall in place, whether it is to do with your work, your client, your team. Today, digital is changing so rapidly, it is actually impossible to keep track of what is trending, what is the new format, what is the new app, what is this new platform. But if you have ownership and you can stand with your client as a partner rather than just an agency, I think you'll deliver whatever it takes to do it.
All right. So, Suvir, to you, my question would be, coming to the actual creative process behind digital campaigns across multiple platforms, what does the future of social media look like to you?
So on social, Rahul, you know, we follow the 4C model. I'm a very big, you know, advocate of the content community commerce model through the lens of culture. And, you know, culture keeps changing every single day as far as pop culture, as far as relevance, as far as creators are concerned. And we genuinely believe that the future of social eventually will dovetail from content to community to commerce, where everything on social becomes shoppable. Everything is, you know, everything is monetizable and everything dovetails into commerce. And that's really the future of performance related social as far as marketing is concerned.
Sure. So, Advit, you want to take up from here what Suvir said. You want to talk about immersive brand experiences like AR, VR, and how are these agencies leveraging upon them, right? One or two examples maybe.
Yeah, I mean, especially the last 2 years, I think immersive has, you know, taken center stage because of COVID. You know, whether it's product try-on or whether it's you know, transport yourself to some location or to a room or you know, explore this product in 3D. There's so many things, right? I mean, that we can do, and basically, you know, what I believe is, if you look at about from 4-5 years ago to now, so many barriers have been broken down to bring a AR experience to life. So 5 years ago, it was more complex to create a 3D. There were not many platforms. You couldn't do it at scale. The phones and the processors in your phones couldn't really handle it. You had to download an app. So there were so many barriers. But now it's become so seamless and easy for someone to consume an immersive or an AR experience, and even to build immersive and AR experiences, because the community is so big, and you know, there's so much work that's also being done. I think it's really, you know, kind of propelled our growth because, you know, we've been doing so much of that work, and we work officially with the large platforms. And going forward, I think the next 2-3 years, it's only going to become bigger and better. We're working on so many new briefs with respect to AR and camera and 3D from brands in Europe, in Canada, in Southeast Asia. It's huge. The potential is huge. And I don't think that's going away, even post-COVID, when things slowly go back to normal. I think brands have realized the power of immersive experiences and gaming experiences, you know, which we also built. Yeah.
I want to come to Prashant now. Prashant, what do you make out of outsourcing? Like, you know, you want to outsource certain activities. How will it benefit your agencies, your agency in particular? What about quicker turnaround times, or, you know, things like that? How does outsourcing help you?
I mean, you know, what's core to what we do, which is paid search, SEO, content, writing, marketing, creative, is all in-house. We don't outsource
it. But is outsourcing efficient or not?
Well, you know, I have a different take on it. My take is, if it's your core competency, and this is not only, you know, digital or agency, this is basically my belief, right or wrong. If it is your core competency, then it shouldn't be outsourced, right? So typically when we have conversations with startups, right, they're like, you know, we are, you know, hiring tech. Okay. And this is like a internet first startup, and they're talking about like outsourcing tech versus hiring tech. And my take is, it has to be in-house. You can't like give that away, because that's your bread and butter, right? You can't screw around with that. So that same logic applies to us, where whatever's our bread and butter, what we do, we won't outsource. So I don't have an experience of good or bad. It might be great. It might have lots of efficiencies, all of that. What's not our bread and butter, right? Like, we don't have a video powerhouse of creating ads, right? We get ads created through outside agencies, right? So we would actually do the creative, all of that stuff, story writing on all, but someone has to shoot it, right? Someone has to hire the models, etc., all of that stuff. We don't do that. We outsource that. We haven't built that out, and we don't want to compete in that space. But whatever's core to our business, we would never outsource. Whatever's not core to our business, it's actually add-on, auxiliary. We're good to outsource it, and we don't have any, you know, issues with that experience. I don't know if that was the exact, you know, question, whether I answered it aptly or not.
No, 100% makes sense, Prashant.
Rahul, I just want to add, I think I completely agree with what Prashant said. And in fact, the example that he gave even applies to us. You know, we focus on our core strengths, and, you know, we get requirements for an SEO, or we get requirements for content creation or for video production. We straight up say that, guys, we don't do that. That's not our cup of tea. And here are some of the partners that we work with. So I think not an agency, for any company, it's extremely important to, accept and write down, these are our 3, 4, 5 core solutions, services, what we offer. And just, you know, because there's a potential to get some extra revenue by doing something else, we try to get into that. We've gone through that journey, tried to do all that, and we realized that, you know what, this doesn't make any sense. We need to focus and strengthen our core so that we become better and better and better at what we do. And other people will come to us for that, and we go to the others for stuff that we are not good at. And I think especially in the digital and advertising ecosystem, that happens quite a bit because we know so many agencies. Agencies give us work, so we know that that certain agency is good at something else. So we go to that agency and say, "Hey guys, you know, there's a brief for content, there's a brief for SEO. Can you help with that?" So I think there's nothing wrong in outsourcing. In fact, what I have seen is agencies and teams who outsource are really good at what they do themselves because they realize that you need to accept that you can't do everything and you have to outsource a few things and you focus on things that you're good at.
Yeah, just one point over here. I think, you know, what Prashant was mentioning in terms of outsourcing, I feel that if you have an idea, and for example, we guys believe in scaling ideas, and if you have an idea over there and, you know, you are taking the idea through and through, right from the, you know, the customer journey to building a brand and to positioning it and then finally bringing it out to any kind of a tech-led kind of a platform up over there, I think quality issues are there. So, you know, when you are thinking something, you are thinking it through and through till the time you deliver it. Like, it's like a baby, right? So you can't have in between somewhere. There are quality issues which are there. So whether you are outsourcing content or whether you are looking at, you know, even SEO for that matter or any kind of video content, I think there, if you have in-house capabilities, like you mentioned right now, I totally agree with you. If your focus is that, like we have five verticals, and if we are not able to do anything in those five verticals, then of course we go out and say, okay, help us. You know, who is the best in the industry who can help us out? So yeah, I agree with you.
I think outsourcing in agencies should be more worded like partnership, right? If you don't have the right partnership, that outsourcing exactly. might not really work.
Absolutely. Yes. Partnership is the right word. You've hit the nail on the head.
Yeah. So let's move on. Prasad, I want to come next to you where you're going to tell me, how are you planning to seamlessly integrate, you know, marketing and technology, or how are you doing that currently? And how do you want to do this in the future digital campaigns? You know, one or two big ideas that you want to share with us?
Pretty interesting question. Okay. I think I will need some more time to think through it, but I know we have around 30-40 seconds here to do that. But correct me if I'm wrong, you're saying that how to integrate marketing and technology, right? That's what you're saying.
How's your agency doing that?
Fair enough. It's a very interesting one. Okay. Because, you know, from my perspective, if you see my background, okay, IIT Madras class of 93. Okay. So a lot of technology was inbuilt. I started my career, you know, from the technology part of it, and advertising happened as an accident to me. Okay. Someone asked me to look into some AdWords campaign way back in 2006. And suddenly after 14 years, I realized, I have built an agency of around 500 people now. Right. So, but you know what? Very interesting. So, what we have done is that there is a team which we just before to this, someone talked about that partner. Right. The whole idea is that I have hired a few people whose job is to track technology across, not necessarily ad tech and martech. And we call it partnerscape. Okay. So actually there's a scape. It's like a scape, partnerscape, in which we say that in these areas, okay, which are the technologies are happening? It's like our BCG is one. Okay. And then we actually start learning those and then connect with them and then keep on asking them, you know, how do we partner? So I say there are four legs that we have. Of course, media is something that we are known for. Media, creative, then there is data and insights. And the fourth one is the technology leg. And every interactions that we have internally or with the client, okay, we will try to say that, you know, what is the technology there they are in. It's a very different, you know, it's a very right brain, left brain sort of a stuff which is happening. But unless you keep on talking about it, and there are a few success stories which happen, okay, then it probably works. But it is very difficult when you are in midst of from more of a creative media led campaigns which happen, and of course data is happening and people are talking about it and experimenting with it, and of course there are then ad techs and martechs are talking about it, but it's definitely difficult. But if you put up a department, you know, hire some good people, make sure that they are part of the pitches, at least be there, say something, okay, or put some one or two slides, then, you know, delta change a day. And I think after a year or 2 year or a 3 year, you suddenly find a good big technology, insights or a catalyst which happens. So that's what my approach has been, because over a day, I cannot turn to be a, you know, technology company and sort of let go what we have. I mean, someone was talking about what is my core, you know, as a heart of it is our core is to understand the, consumer and, you know, excite him and get him into the that digital assets that he has, right? And of course, technology becomes the enabler, and whether we should do it ourselves or we should outsource is again the question we start. But do we know all those things is something I think it's a better thing to start. I think I would answer in that those 30, 40 seconds or higher that I did that. Yeah.
Being steady is the core.
Yeah.
So Sanjay, closing remarks from you. Can you talk about some challenges and opportunities that you expect to witness in the digital marketing ecosystem in the coming months, maybe just talk about 2021 or beginning 2020.
So I have one comment to make where Prasad said, and then Prasad, I think, you know, we are following your the way you are running your company, and it is amazing and it is quite inspiring over there. You know, when you are looking at hiring people who are looking at technology, we call ourselves as a tech-led company. Basically, we are a tech-led marketing company. So a set of people that we have with almost 25 to 28 years of experience have been on the offline side, where you're talking about consumer behavior, you're talking about brand, you are talking about positioning, you're talking about brand structures over there. Okay. And suddenly you find, okay, now, you know, everything has gone digital. How? So there is a way where you are taking a tech platform and then building all this up over there, right? So what stops us from thinking that when you are creating a website, it should not be driven in a manner that how a consumer is going to land on your website and how the consumer journey is going to be, right? This we did like in offline also, right? We used to do customer journey mapping, we used to do over there. So just because the platform has become technology does not mean that the whole marketing that was done offline has gone down the drain. No, it is not possible. So I totally agree. So we are a tech-led marketing company, and I think one of the challenges like you just mentioned is that good talented people is something that, you know, that's always going to remain a challenge for whether it is 1 year down the line or 5 years down the line. I think good talented people, and Shraddha also mentioned that ownership. I think that's something that is very important for people who are joining digital marketing companies. It's not for fun, right? There's a lot of, you are a brand custodian standing over there for your customer, because you are day in and day out churning out content, data, creatives, everything. A whole lot of communication is going out from your or from their platform, for which you should be, you know, there should be ownership over there. The second bit, I think what we also need to do is, as agencies, we also need to educate our customers. Okay. Because what is happening is, unfortunately, at many places we see customers and consumers and our clients are also just going ahead. They read something. Okay. Content across, and they read, are excited by it, but they don't know whether their brand is going to be able to live that particular journey or no. I think so. It's very important that at least clients who have moved from offline and coming into online, a lot amount of investment in terms of educating them becomes a very, very big proposition over here for all of us. And I think it's a responsibility. And the last part, which is there, is I think impact and data. Because at the end of the day, digital is all about measurement. If you are able to measure it well, if you are able to show that impact, whether it is to the society, to the country, to the brand, or to the common people, I think that's something that will really help. So these are the three. I think it's a mix of opportunities and challenges that I feel that are there. And yes, of course, you will find good talented people. But I think a lot of unlearning has also happened in this phase for a lot of people. And new learnings are coming in, like Advit also mentioned. Yeah, these are my thoughts, open to any kind of feedback and thoughts.
That makes sense, Sanjay. And I think great closing on that. And I guess the relationship between clients and agencies is further going to evolve. After I've heard all of you, I can at least make this statement. But it will come with willingness to experiment, which has to be at the heart of creating very successful campaigns that we have seen last week, right? And while there is no dearth of opportunities that I can say, for digital agencies, the creation of immersive and engaging experiences would constitute a major chunk of campaigns in the coming future. And in order to satisfy the clients, your reach out to the right set of audience, that's going to take the center stage. Right. With that note, and on that note, thank you so much, Suvir, Prashant, Advit, Prasad, Sanjay, and Shraddha for joining us today. It was really a wonderful, great, enriching discussion.